today, which is working session number 3 about development experience in India. The chairperson is Dr. Pulleen Nayak, and I hand over to him now.
Well, thank you very much. And let me begin by paying my compliments once again to Shoibal Babu for organizing this conference so very nicely and meticulously. Now, this morning I was asked to, for some reason, the stated chairperson is unable to come. So here I am, and I'm very happy to be here in the position I've been asked to hold. Now, this is, I'll just take a minute or two trying to introduce. I think there's some people, I think it's moving about a bit. But this is a very important moment in this seminar. The topic is development experience in India. And of course, the overall seminar theme is development and growth. So I think this session is going to be very important, I feel. And for a minute or two, let me just give you some of my very quick thoughts on it. Talking about development, when we look at or when we consider development in India today, in the past year, the growth rate of the Indian economy has been, as everyone in this room knows, 7.5% or so. We have tipped the Chinese growth rate, which is around 7.1% or so. But not just that. If you look at the average of the advanced countries, it is barely about 2.2% of all the advanced Western countries, Japan included, and North America. If you look at all the developing countries, the growth rate is somewhere around 4% or so. So India definitely is at a very significant position, and particularly because when you look at the growth rate of Brazil and Russia in the past year, it is in the negative zone, as some of you possibly know. Two of the major BRICS countries in the negative zone, and India at 7.5%. So everything seems to be going very well, but we must immediately try to understand. Growth rate is very good, but what about development? The answer, at least I would have to say, is a sad in the negative direction, sad no. And India has many, many deficits. Deficits on the ground of gender, deficit on the ground of the inequalities that is being perpetrated, it's getting much sharper. Deficits on the basis of health and education. You know, on health, India, till 3 or 4 years back, used to spend less than 1 percentage point of GDP in public expenditure. It was one of the lowest, and today it is 1.3%. Again, one of the very lowest in the entire world. In the entire world. China is around 2.9%. Western Europe is rather in the range of about 8%. Netherlands is more than 10%. This is expenditure on public health. I don't want to hold forth too much, but we are at a very important point. We have two very eminent scholars from Japan who are going to focus on two very important issues in the development arena. The first is going to be on the manufacturing sector, and as you possibly know, in the Indian context, manufacturing is possibly our weakest point, for the reason that the share of manufacturing in GDP has remained stagnant at about 15% for the last more than a decade, definitely. China is at around 32% or so. And as you possibly know, manufacturing is the most dynamic sector of the industrial group. And India's showing on manufacturing is very bad. Is very bad. It's stagnant virtually. And because of its stagnancy, the position on the job creation is very bad. Manufacturing is the sector that creates the maximum jobs. So we are cutting a sorry figure in terms of job growth. That is manufacturing. And the second issue has to do with land reforms. We are going to have a very important paper on land reforms. So without losing any further time, first of all, I also welcome our Japanese friends who are coming in. It's very important and very nice that scholars from Asia are looking at the Indian development experience and trying to analyze it. I think this is very important for us. And I, at the edge, I feel at the margin, it's probably more important for us than the European and the American scholars who come. Of course, there are many, many Indian scholars, but we value the contribution of Japanese scholars in this. At a very early point in the 50s, 60s, there was a great Japanese scholar looking at the Indian development experience, and there is the so-called deindustrialization debate with Tapan Rai Chowdhury, Taro Matsui, and Maurice de Maurice. You might remember that. So some of the Japanese scholars have been very keen observers and serious observers of the development process in India. So I welcome the Japanese scholars, and without losing any further time, I invite Professor Atsushi Kato, professor from Aoyama Gakuin University, to make his presentation, please. I would say 10 to 15 minutes, each of you. 10 to 15 minutes? Yeah, because we have a 1 hour. So 15, say 10 minutes, and then some discussion. 15 to 20 minutes, okay. All right. Thank you. It's a technical problem, so if somebody can kindly help. So I think for sake of keeping to time, I would request the second scholar to make the first presentation. He has kindly offered, and I have taken up the offer. Would you tell your friend to come back and you start? In the meantime, they'll figure out. So sir, you can start and then figure out. Sorry about the technical glitch. So we are going to have the second presentation first. So I welcome Professor Koichi Fujita, professor at Kyoto University, reevaluating land reforms in West Bengal. Please. Yeah.
So good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to take this opportunity to appreciate very much to the organizer of ADRI to invite me to this very important conferences. Today, my talk is about land reforms in West Bengal again. Already 30, 40 years have passed since this program was implemented, and but still, during these 30, 40 years, many things happened, and situations has drastically changed. But still, this issue is very important. So I will want to again re-evaluate this important issue from the perspective of comparative analysis of Bangladesh, West Bengal, and Bihar. Okay. So first, there are some major issue, arguments why the Eastern India has lagged behind in its agriculture sector development, especially. One very famous hypothesis is semi-feudal model or semi-feudal hypothesis, especially Amit Bhadauri, Professor Amit Bhadauri was a major argument. But if we adopt this hypothesis, we cannot explain one important fact that one is since 1980s, Bangladesh and West Bengal started agricultural growth, and Bihar not so much until today. But even in Bihar, since mid-1960s, in wheat sector, Bihar achieved a tremendous growth in wheat production, as these two figures shows. Okay, so we cannot explain by the semi-feudal model why only wheat, not rice, grew rapidly in Bihar. Okay. Next is a another major hypothesis why Eastern India lagged behind is land fragmentation hypothesis. And this hypothesis was submitted mainly by P.K. Bardhan the first day he presented. And since the 1960s, without land consolidation project to correct this land fragmentation problem, Eastern India agricultural growth started without this because of the development of groundwater markets. Okay, so it was not the major problem. This is my conclusion. And why then in the 1980s this development in tube wells started in Eastern India? It was lagged behind from North India or other parts of India. Is that my hypothesis is not not yet I am very confirmed, but delayed in tube well diffusion in Eastern India is that the technology of innovation in the 1980s in tube wells may happen. And that led to the substantial cost down of the tube well irrigation. That may be the major cause. Still, I'm not so sure, but this is a tentative, my hypothesis, okay? Okay, now I would like to talk about how agricultural growth happened in West Bengal and Bangladesh in particular. It was preceded by West Bengal since 1980s. And then Bangladesh also started but accelerated after mid-1990s. Okay, so Bangladesh was a little bit later started its agricultural growth. But Bihar, you can, as you can see from this figure, this is a rice production almost stagnant until very recently. Okay, and there are major arguments that because of the land reforms started since 1977, when Left Front government was took power in West Bengal, that was and the land reform program was a major cause for the agricultural development since 1980s. It is a little bit widely accepted still, I believe. But I doubt it, basically, to this argument. And first, there are, of course, two major land reform programs. One is a land redistribution. And another is Operation Barga, protection of registered sharecroppers. And the first one is based on the famous argument that the inverse relation between farm size and output per acre or something like that. And this also arguments also comprised of the static one and the dynamic one. Both, I believe, small farmers is more efficient. It is, I agree. And but okay, next, Operation Barga program, it's believed that there is a famous Marshallian inefficiency in sharecropping system, as Professor Bardan already argued. And combating this Marshallian efficiency, is correct or not? Okay, and this, I put here is a very important research by Professor Baumik in Bangla, okay? Tenancy Relations and Agrarian Development. This is published in 1993. And, okay.
Yes, people at the end to kindly, at the very end, to kindly not talk loudly, please.
Okay, and land rent share in reality, okay. As you know, under Operation Barga, land rent is limited, maximum 25%. But this regulation is how effective is depending on the crops. In the case of almond rice, the market rate of land share is 50%, as this table shows, so that 25% regulation is more effective. But in boro rice, actually, because of the high cost for irrigation and other inputs, the market equilibrium land rent is 25%. That is not almost the same with the 25% regulation. So that, in that sense, this the regulation is not so effective. So we should first note this crop-wise differences. Then, how we can find Marshallian inefficiency in the reality shows. This table shows that we should compare owned land and sharecropped land of the same owner cum tenants. This is a point, okay? In the case of UR means unregistered sharecroppers. This is not protected by Operation Barga. The gap between owned land and sharecropped land is very large. This shows the inefficiency of a sharecropping system. But under registered sharecroppers, as you can see from this table, the gap narrowed. And in the case of almond rice, but not so much in borrow rice. Because of the, as I said already, 25% regulation is not so effective in borrow rice. Okay? So this table shows Marshallian inefficiency was reduced because of the Operation Barga, but still remains in both Amon and Boro. So in that sense, Operation Barga was the second best solution, not perfectly solved the problem of sharecropping. So this finding I want to support by the case of Bangladesh. Here, this is an econometric model results by myself using a census data of Bangladesh. And you can see effects of share tenancy on productivity under controlled land quality and farm size. Land quality means high land, medium land, and low land. This land is categorized into three, and medium land is taken as a reference here. Okay, and you can see that there I have measured according to two farm size groups, smaller one and a larger one. And you can find this negative effects of shared tenancy can only be observed among the large farm size group, not small farm size group. And this, in 1986, a very famous economist, Janssen, wrote Rural Bangladesh, Competition for Scarce Resources. And in this book, there is a very famous phrase that support my econometric analysis result. There is little doubt that a tenant who feels he is competing hard on an open market to obtain a plot for sharecropping will increase his efforts to produce a good crop. On the other hand, an owner come tenant who, for different reasons, may have a more long-lasting sharecropping contract will put more labor efforts and inputs into his own land instead of sharecropped land. This is his statement. And this is why this is important in the context of Bangladesh agriculture is that, as you can see from this big table, that major farmers who rent in land is not landless or marginal farmers, but medium farmers. And marginal farmers, instead, they leased out to other farmers. This is a reality of the rental market in Bangladesh. And I believe that this kind of characteristic is also observed in India as well. And I called this type of tenancy market as South Asian type of tenancy market. It's totally different from the experience of Japan and also China or Korea. Because China, East Asian countries, I will show this very important statement that in Japan, by the end of 17th century means after 100 years since Tokugawa era started, so long ago, okay, the peasant society was established. And after that, the basic rural agrarian structure not changed, even after Meiji Restoration or Second World War, anything. And under the unequal land distribution, tenancy market highly developed in pre-war Japan, okay, before land reforms after Second World War, with almost no landless class, so that you can see that here, pre-war Japan and contemporary South Asia, almost same land ownership distribution, very unequal. This is same. But what is difference is a tenancy market. In pre-war Japan, tenancy market worked as like this. So in operational farm size distribution, almost not so small, too small farmers or too large farmers was non-existent. But in contemporary South Asia, through the tenancy market, the size distribution was not so much changed. And yes, so this is very important issue. So now I would like to present that I doubt the impact of land reforms on agricultural output growth. Why? One is small share, only 70% of land was under reforms. Second, if Operation Barga was murdered, why and how can we explain agriculture growth in Bangladesh almost the same period? Okay, and the real factors, which I mean, I believe for the agriculture growth in both West Bengal and Bangladesh after the 1980s is two. One is expansion of boro rice with private shallow tubular irrigation. Second, gradual diffusion of high yielding varieties suitable to local diverse agroecological conditions in Aotian Amur rice. So this shows the two major factors. I will skip, but okay. So puzzle of backwardness in Bihar rice agriculture. Because I said that the wheat, in wheat sector, Bihar achieved a lot since the mid-1960s because of the rapid private tube wells, almost same as that happened in Punjab. But that tube well has not been used for rice cultivation in monsoon season. This is a major factor why rice yield has been stagnant so long period in Bihar. And because under the climate condition of Bihar, high yielding varieties could not be accepted without frequent irrigation. Every 3-4 days, paddy should be irrigated if farmers adopt high yielding varieties. Local varieties, no problem, but high yielding varieties should be irrigated very frequently. But actually not irrigated because of the high price of water, power, 60 rupees or 100 rupees even at this moment. And this is a side evidence of my argument that tube well irrigation and rice yield is not positively correlated. Slightly negatively correlated, unlike other sectors. Okay? So I will skip this. So now I want to conclude that impact of land reforms on economic growth in West Bengal, I refuse that impact of land reforms on agricultural output growth, but I believe that it contributed to economic growth in general in that state because of the large number of beneficiaries of land reforms and their income rose. So purchasing power also rose. Then purchasing power increase stimulated the development of agricultural and also non-agricultural sectors. This is actually very important overall impact. Okay. Because I have no time more, so I will conclude. There was basically no positive impact of land reforms on agriculture output growth in West Bengal, but contributed to economic growth, as I already mentioned. Okay. Lastly, this picture is very indicative. This picture, vertical side is axis is average farm size, and horizontal is SC's schedule caste peoples, how they are engaged in farming, self-employed farming. So you can see Punjab, Haryana, Gujarat is a very low participation of SC, but West Bengal so much higher, and Tamil Nadu and Bihar is in between. Maybe Bihar should be should move to the West Bengal direction so that for the purpose of the economic growth in general. This is my conclusion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Fujita, for that very important contribution. We will take questions later. I will now invite Professor Kato to make his presentation.
I imagine that even if a riot occurs in the Bagalpur, the life goes on in Patna, and people need to work to earn their bread. So therefore, we have not obtained significant estimation result with respect to the impact of internal violent conflicts on a series of dependent variables, such as per capita GDP, GDP growth rate, investment rate, industrial output and its growth rate, and that this list goes on. But somehow we got significant statistical results for manufacturing sector. So I will report our results. Due to the time limitation, I have to skip many PowerPoint sheets. Although the civil wars have attracted disproportionately much attention of scholars, there is a variety of other internal violent conflicts, such as riots, terrorist attacks, demonstration, protests, pogrom, genocide, lynching, feuds, gang assaults, and so on. While there is a large literature on the causes of violent conflicts, such as those on civil wars, riots, terrorist attacks, but there is a relatively scarce literature on the consequence of internal violent conflict, especially those with respect to the economic consequences. Within this small literature, recently the economic consequences of civil wars have become known relatively better. In contrast, the economic consequences of violent conflicts of a scale smaller than civil wars, such as riots, are yet to be known well. Although they are smaller in sizes or fatality, if they occur more frequently and recurrently, their cumulative effects on the economy could be large. Collier, 1999, lists five effects of civil war on the economy. And we believe that those effects can be applied to other kinds of violent conflict, though the effect of extent of the impact may be smaller. The first is called a destruction effect. Civil war destroys some economic resources, damaging the economy. The secondary, by disruption effect, civil wars disrupt social order and suppress the civil liberty, imposing extra cost on the economic activity. Thirdly, through the diversion effect, public expenditure is diverted from output-enhancing activities to military activities. Fourthly, by this saving effect, saving available to investment shrinks and capital cost rises. And lastly, portfolio substitution effects induces people to shift their assets to foreign country, reducing domestic capital. Collier, the same paper in 1999, has shown that the sizes and features of negative impacts of civil war depends on the vulnerability of each sector. Then he classifies economic activities into war-invulnerable sectors, war-vulnerable sectors, and unclassified sectors. And the manufacturing sector is considered to be relatively more vulnerable to violent conflict than agriculture. Gross domestic products of each state in India is composed of the output of sectors both invulnerable and vulnerable to violent conflicts. In India, agriculture accounts for a large share of the economy. Violent conflicts may not affect the aggregate economy. Hence, we focus special attention to manufacturing sector as a representative of sectors vulnerable to violent conflicts. Based on the argument so far, we will explain our hypothesis. First, in this study, we capture the intensity of violent conflicts by three kinds of measures, namely the number of violent conflicts, the number of fatalities, and the number of participants in violent conflicts. Many previous studies take the number of violent conflict as a main dependent or explanatory variables. However, the variable is constructed by putting equal weight both on a violent conflict in which thousands of people participate and there incur many fatalities, and the same equal weight on a violent conflict in which only dozens of people join and a few people get injured. Accordingly, in this study, we do take the number of deaths and the participants as additional explanatory variable to capture the brutality of violent conflicts. Our second hypothesis is that the violent conflicts reduce capital-labor ratio, while they may or may not affect total factor productivity, as well as gross value added per worker. On one hand, violent conflicts may damage physical assets. So economic agents facing the risk of violence may refrain from investing in physical assets, especially those with sunk costs. Also, they may move physical assets to other peaceful states, or they may substitute labor for physical capital. On the other hand, the loss of lives is relatively less in most internal violent conflicts than in civil wars. Moreover, people need to work even if there occurs a riot, violent conflicts somewhere in the same state. With respect to total factor productivity, violent conflicts do not destroy business ideas created by business persons, and thus the part of total factor productivity that is based on the business idea should not be seriously affected. Total factor productivity is, as is well known, a catch-all index capturing all the residual factors that are not explained by factors considered in the estimation. So for instance, through the disruption effect, the part of total factor productivity that depends on the social capital may be deteriorated by violent conflict. Hence, the size of the effects of violent conflicts on TFP is an empirical question. Lastly, since the gross value added per worker is a weighted sum of capital labor ratio and total factor productivity, the impact of violent conflict is another empirical question. Our third hypothesis is that the negative impacts of ethnic and religious violent conflicts are more salient than those of political or economic violent conflict. Among the five effects by Collier, those of disruption, and diversion are primary direct effects of the violent conflicts. It is reasonable to suppose that the impact through these direct effects of the violent conflicts of a smaller scale, in parallel to definition, would be smaller. The last two effects of the violent conflict, namely the saving and portfolio substitution effects, are the consequence of the change in the behavior of economic agents. This effect works through the change in the prediction by economic agent. So observing violent conflicts in an area, economic agents change their prediction about the future occurrence of the violent conflict and their probable damage to them. If a significant number of people perceive the risk of violence targeted to them to be high, they would change their economic action to a large extent, and the consequence could be high. Then in ethnic and religious conflicts, target of a people is more clearly defined and more easily identified. The member of the potential target group may be seriously concerned that they may be attacked and they may change their behavior. In contrast to ethnic or religious identity, people may from time to time change their support to the political party or go up and down the ladder of the economic classes. So it may be relatively more difficult to organize people in a political or economic group than in the cases of ethnic or religious group. Our fourth hypothesis is that negative impact of violent conflicts nested in a larger conflict is larger than those that independently occur. For instance, communal conflicts between Muslim and Hindu people has been persistent, recurrent, and large scale. So the impact of a violent conflict that occurs in the context of such communal conflicts may have a larger impact on the economic behavior of involved people compared with a discrete violent conflict that occur independently of such large conflict. In this study, we use a data set called India Subnational Problem Set, which is constructed by Center for Systemic Peace. They compiled the data set from the Kissing's record of world events, and the period from 1960 to 2004 is covered at the present time. It is not a perfect data set of violent conflicts in India, but due to the lack of alternative data set at this moment, we rely on it in this study. And then they count an incident as a conflict if it is violent, meaning at least one death or substantial property destruction, and if it is inherently political. This figure reports the total number of deaths in violent conflict in each year in our data set. 1990 recorded the highest number of deaths, namely mainly due to the Rath Yatra, and then of course the number in 93 is needless to say related to Ayodhya. The high number of deaths was recorded in 2002 when Godla riot occurred. 1983 also saw the large number of fatalities, a part of which is due to the large massacre in Assam. Note that the reason why there are not so many deaths in 1984 is that the Delhi is not included in our data set.
Sorry, this is for India?
India, yes. Our basic estimation model is as follows. ZI is the natural log of the economic performance variable of manufacturing sector. XI is a variable that captures the intensity of violent conflicts. YI is a vector of control variables. And the state dummy, theta I, and year dummy, is theta T, are included in the estimation. Then our sample period is from the 1973 to 2004. Then our dependent variable, economic performance variable, is like as follows. In this study, we primarily focus on the effect of violent conflict on the gross value added per worker of manufacturing sector in 28 states. much in 1993 rather than 1992. So those effects are captured by this sum. Well, although it is a most important part of our study, I do not have enough time to explain how to construct our violent conflict variable in detail now, so I have to skip this. In addition to violent conflict variable, we control for physical infrastructure and human capital conditions of each state I in year T. Then the endogeneity in the relationship between economic performance and violent conflict is a reasonable concern. To address the endogeneity problem, we consider, we conduct an instrumental variable two-stage least square estimation. Based on the large literature on the causes of riots, we have tried a variety of political and social variables as instrumental variables. Among them, only the combination of log number of policemen per populations and Muslim-Hindu population ratio produces acceptable values of the statistics for weak instrument tests. So we use them as our instruments. And this is a table of descriptive statistics. From this table, it's so small, but it is observed that the frequency of ethnic violent conflicts is high compared with other types of conflicts. We do not observe any high correlation between any pair of explanatory variables. So from now, I will report our estimation result. First, this table shows the first stage estimation result for the aggregate number of violent conflict per person as our explanatory variable. The results of our R-squared S-test and the identification test are reasonable, but the test statistics for the weak identification test is not so strongly supportive of the validity of our estimation. There is a concern for the estimation for aggregate number of the conflicts and the deaths and participants. This table presents the result of the second stage estimation. Test statistic for endogeneity test is high with p-values close to zero in columns 1 and 2, but not in column 3, which implies that the column 3 corresponds to TFP estimation, so which implies that the number of violent conflicts and total factor productivity are not endogenous, and IV instrumental variable estimation is not appropriate. So thus, we omit the explanation on TFP hereafter. And then the test statistics for over-identification test is seems reasonable. Then our estimation result in column 1 shows that the coefficient of number of violent conflicts per population has a negative coefficient at 5% significance level for gross value added per worker. And then columns 2 has a negative coefficient at 1% significance level for capital labor ratio. Then this pattern of the estimation result is the same across all the following estimation. Next one is the estimation result for the number of deaths in violent conflicts per population. Then we have the same estimation result. Then even if we use the number of participants per population, we get the same result, a similar result. Then summary for the total number of violent conflicts, total number of deaths, and total number of participants, violent conflict measured in this explanatory variable all significantly reduced the gross value added per worker and capital ratio. In contrast, the intensity of violent conflict measured by three variables does not produce any significant coefficient for total factor productivity. Then from here, we conducted the estimation for a subgroup of the conflict. So these results are related to the ethnic violent conflicts. So explanatory variable include only ethnic violent conflict. Then, although it is not shown here, for ethnic as well as religious conflict, weak instrumental tests are more easily passed. So I would say that the estimation results are more reliable for ethnic and religious violent conflict than the estimation result for the total number of conflicts. Then we get the similar result like this. So in summary, for ethnic violent conflicts, ethnic and religious violent conflicts have a negative impact on gross value added per worker and capital labor ratio of manufacturing sector. And also it is tentative. We do not find the evidence that other types of violent conflicts affect the economic performance of manufacturing sector. Then the lastly, we show the estimation result for the estimation in which the explanatory variable is the violent conflict nested in a larger conflict, then we have the similar kind of result. Then in summary, violent conflict nested in a larger conflict have been shown to affect the negatively gross value added per worker and capital labor ratio of manufacturing sector. Well, even though it is not shown in the PowerPoint sheet, discrete violent conflict do not. Among nested violent conflict, those nested in a mega conflict have a larger negative impact than those nested in the meta conflict, which is a little smaller scale than the mega conflict. In conclusion, violent conflict measured by the number of incidents, the number of deaths, and the number of participants all reduce gross value added per worker and capital labor ratio of manufacturing sector, but not total factor productivity. And the deleterious effects of the violent conflicts are more salient in ethnic and religious conflict and those nested in a large conflict. So hence, communal conflicts between Muslim and Hindu people and Sikh separatist movement, Assamese exclusion movement, or Jammu Kashmir conflict, which all have a large scale and ethnic and religious context, have most serious negative effects on the manufacturing sector. But other conflicts, such as riots that occur during the election period, or riots that occurred when the reservation policy was recommended or adopted, do not have as much economic impact on the as the former ones. Thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you, Professor Kato. You know, it so happens that he has to catch a flight pretty soon, so he has to. So we are sorry to have to lose Professor Kato for the discussion session, but he has to catch a flight, and 12:15 he has to go. So. They say that you have to go. Okay. So you can stay for 15 minutes more. Thank you very much. So we proceed. We proceed, and I'm going to invite Sri Vikas Temble to make the comments of the discussion. Thank you.
Okay, so let me just start with thanking both the presenters, you know, for the wonderful paper. They just gave me an opportunity to think both these very important development problems over the last couple of weeks and look into the evidence, in general, what is the other papers and what all the evidence say, and I really like both the papers and presentations. So what I'm basically going to do in next 5 to 7 minutes is not actually go in particulars of the regression estimations or the technicalities of that paper or give any comments on that, but rather just take the issues both of them presented and then put them in a context of Indian development experience and where we stand right now. So the the two topics I'm going to focus on, agricultural productivity, that came out from the first paper, and then, like, you know, in general, conflict, and what does it mean for economic growth, and what's the evidence that we have. So the firstly, like, land reforms and West Bengal, I mean, the best I can say about it is, like, the evidence till now is kind of contradictory. The paper by Abhijit Banerjee and others at General Political Economy shows that the Operation Begha probably they explained around 28% of the productivity growth in West Bengal, and that's the 2002 paper, and their model is like a quite rigorous model, which I tend to believe. But then there is a paper which you mentioned as well by Dilip Mukherjee and Pranab Vardhan, which actually take into the account the farm level productivity and shows that, like, the impact of land reforms on productivity is almost none. I mean, statistically, you can't say anything. I personally tend to believe the second paper, not because, Dilip Mukherjee is my boss and I report him directly, but their estimations and the data they use is, like, farm level, I believe that paper and then the findings from that more. But then, even if that kept in mind, the issue is this. So in last 30 years, not just agriculture, but in like majority of the sectors, West Bengal is lacking behind. So there was a time when West Bengal was like the industrialization front, or like, even the social front, that was the state that was at the forefront of Indian development experience. But then if what has happened in last three decades is lacking behind all major indicators. I mean, so every year my organization, the International Growth Center, organizes conference in West Bengal, the West Bengal Growth Conference, we call it, and we get like who's who of Bengali economists there. This year we got Arvind Subramanian to give the keynote, and his the experience, the topic he spoke was on like the comparative perspective on West Bengal's development experience. And this is how he started. He quoted Dante saying, like, well, the most miserable time in the life, I mean, the greatest sorrow of the life is when you have to remember the good times at the times of misery. And that's the, the sentiment of his presentation was basically saying, like, okay, on all major fronts, West Bengal used to be a very good state, but then that lagged behind. The reason I'm mentioning that here in this context is, I don't know what would have happened, let's say, if the land reform would have taken place in a context where the better functioning institutions were there. So let's say if, like, other states, like maybe Tamil Nadu, Punjab, I don't know, Maharashtra or somewhere else, where the agricultural institutions or, like, the infrastructure related to agriculture, the better functioning institution states, had they had land reforms, what would have been the impacts? That's the first question that come to mind. And like, or like, even in this, if there had not been like institutional decline of the West Bengal in general, what would have been the impact of the the land reform? That's the important question. But like that, keeping that in mind also, like the basic question of agricultural productivity doesn't go away. So take example after example, and this is what I'm going to do, like very quickly give you 2 to 3 examples, which will clearly show you that like agricultural productivity is probably one of the most important issue that we are facing at this point of time. Here is the yield or like the productivity of the paddy. Paddy and wheat are our two most important cereals. Most of the states produce it. Lot of our irrigated land goes on it, and lot of our agricultural subsidies go to it. But then, what does happen? I mean, see this graph and you will see that most of our states, the productivity is lower than the world. Our overall productivity is lower than the world. And not just that, our base state, the Punjab, the productivity of Punjab is also lower than China. So, there's like a lot of scope for productivity increase there. The same with the wheat. The overall, our average productivity is lower than the world. Most of the states are lower than not just China, but then also the Bangladesh, and not just West Bengal, like most of the states. For the pulses, same thing. I mean, our productivity is at the level of Africa, and like, well, keep in mind, pulses are like, we are the major producer of pulses at the global level, and still this is the case. So. And then, like, what does all this mean is this have like direct impact on the farmer and agricultural incomes. So The basic point is, even not just in West Bengal, but across the state, we have this major issue of agricultural productivity. And so my analysis of this is like, well, there are like 3 to 4 major points. And like, well, major things, the reason why agricultural productivity is lacking. So basically, one could be the variation within state. So not just like, well, don't look at the China, don't look at the US, just look at the variation within state. If we can actually make sure that like the state converts towards even the middle or median state, our productivity would increase quite high. Second is like, well, the water along with land is one of the most scarce resource that we have. We need to make sure that somehow, you know, we use water properly, and then, you know, the distribution water is like equitable. The third and most important point I want to make is the research, agricultural research and education related thing. So look at this. The graph shows that the per 1,000 number of students in agricultural universities, and what's the share of the GDP in agriculture. And the more actually the share of GDP in agriculture, basically the poorer state who should actually, focusing on the agricultural productivity and the agricultural research are not doing that. I mean, these are the states, they are the poor ones, they need to go and like, you know, the focus on the agricultural productivity. And apart from this point, there are like other two important points. I mean, the price spread that we all will, like, you know, everybody knows the difference between farm gate prices and the prices at the market are very wide, and agriculture infrastructure there, lacking agriculture infrastructure has more role to play that. So this is basically, very short comments on what you said. Regarding the conflict, In 2 minutes, again, I'm not going to be, in 1 minute, I'm not going to go, any econometric estimations or something. But then, as you yourself said, the conflict is like one of the major development related issue. Around 25% of the countries face civil war related thing. Like, you know, there is at least conflict or civil wars in 25% of the countries in the world. No surprise, the poorer the countries, more the world violence are, and the civil wars are. Unfortunately, despite all this, the work on the civil war or like the conflict is very less. Two most important underdevelopment, development economic books, Debraj Ray and like Todorov books, none of them have the word conflict or violence in their index. So we tend to focus less on this issue. And one of the reason why it's under research area is because of the data and the research question itself. Because the poorer states with the poor institution tend to get more conflicts, and then when you try to do the economic evaluation of the comparative perspective, there might be it's not that violence leading to economic backwardness. It could just be the reason that economic backwardness is leading to the conflict. So these are very important issues, very under research, and I thank you and compliment you that you are trying to address it at least to some level. Thanks.
Thank you, Vikas. So friends, I think we still have some time, and since he had mentioned 15 minutes, we do have some time. We can take a few questions, but they should all be very sharply pointed, please. I would request.
Thank you. My question is to Professor Kato. I think a macro analysis and a relationship between violent conflict and manufacturing productivity, it's too simplistic a statement in a country of India's size. India is too big for that, and I think to attribute everything to a decline in productivity or this or that, value added, I think it's too simplistic a statement, and there is a need to relook into other factors as well.
My comment to Professor Kato, it is very much interesting issue, but a very simple technical comments. You are applying two-way error component model. okay, fixed effects by taking the time effect as well as the cross-section effects. And you have taken time periods since 1973 to 2004. Okay? So total number of variables in your model, including the time effects, cross-section effects, several dummy variables relating to conflicts, indicators, as well as control variables. So there is a huge number of explanatory variables in your model. So there may be some problem of huge loss of degrees of freedom in your model. So how do you tackle it?
Very much. You have a question, sir?
My question, first question about the effect of land reforms on...
only one question, we don't have
time. Yes, only one question. Maybe one question for one...
One question, sir, I think it, there may be, one question.
You did mention that Tuval's irrigation was available, still it was not utilized for rice production. Why? That's one question. The second question, if you don't permit, then I will not.
I will not. I will not. There is a question coming there. Yeah. At the very end. I'm sorry about that because there's lack of time.
This question is for Dr. Sujita. Fujita, you said the effect of, you gave example of two papers having conflicting conclusions about the impact of land reforms. I was wondering whether this conflict can be resolved by taking the framework which Professor Pranab Vardhan said in the morning, what he called partial equilibrium effects and the general equilibrium effects. I think that will be more important to explain this difference.
I think that's a very last question. Yeah. And please be pointed, and because time is short. Thank you.
My question is to Professor Kato. Do you think that the type of conflict may have different form of consequences in the economic growth? Because when we talk of conflict, it could be because of the internal conflict, reasons for the development-induced conflict, or the political, just a political reason. And in that context, your economic growth actually affect in developing countries, conflict may be a group of people who are directly affected, but when you talk of the political unrest and that leads to conflict, it actually affects in a larger mass. So where, how do you actually differentiate the consequences in that, that context?
Thank you very much. And I would ask, I also, so what do you want to answer? Your first answer, and then 2 to 3 minutes.
Thank you very much for useful comments and questions. The first comments by Professor Ruman, it's really true that I totally agree that it's too simplistic. So I'm sure that I have to do further research into the channels through which the conflicts affect the performance of the manufacturing sector. Thank you very much. And then next question by Professor Das about the loss of the degrees of freedom. We conducted the separate estimation for each pair of the dependent variables, explanatory variables. So we do not put in every kind of explanatory variable and the dependent variable in that one equation. So degrees of freedom is, I think it's not so too much, I believe. I don't quite understand the comment by the last one. Sorry.
Thank you very much for many comments and so questions. My basic message today is I would like to repeat a little bit. The major factor for the agricultural growth since 1980s was not institutional, but basically technological. And two major investments was very important in that sense. One is that private investment in tube wells, and another is investment is in R&D by the government. And my major message today is our social scientist is usually overemphasize the institutions, not technology. So I was graduated from the or Bangladesh, because of the small hose, they use the hose to convey the water to the field. And that kind of technology is totally different from the tubers in spread in West Bengal and Bangladesh. And that caused maybe the water price. That is my hypothesis, okay? And the last one is a spillover effects mentioned by Professor Bardam. Yes, but I don't know concretely how is the spillover effects of the land reforms to other sectors. I'm not so sure, but today I discussed another type of general equilibrium effect, that is through increased purchasing power in rural areas. Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much, and I think everyone will agree that these were two very important papers and very good discussion also. So a big hand to the paper presenters and the discussers. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Once again, Adri has some very well-crafted mementos for all of you, so please remain in your seats.
Thank you.